Welcome to Scott Stream. You can follow me at scotthamburg.com. Also, follow me on Telegram. We've got a channel there. It's called, lo and behold, Scott Stream. Go follow there. I'm going to do more of these call-ins on all manner of topics, and I will do those there in the Telegram software. And of course, you can follow me on Instagram. I made that channel private, so if you want to follow me there, where I'll announce other things I'm doing, DM me so I can find out where you came from, so I can get rid of all the sort of social justice wieners that have been following me and griping and telling me I was slut shaming and all that kind of shit. I just don't need that. So I made the account private, but you folks that listen to this show are certainly welcome. So go there and let me know you listen to this, and I'll let you follow, and then you can see all the announcements, everything we do, and follow that Scott Stream there on Telegram, and I'll schedule shows there, and you can see the schedule there. We've already got one. This is going to be about strength training. This is going to be my first call-in show. It might be a disaster. But if Ben Shapiro can do it, and he's a fucking retard, I know I can. So I've already got Zach. Let's hear. Boom. Click. Zach has a question. Go, man. Oh, my God. Well, maybe he doesn't. He actually told me what it was beforehand. We practiced this before.
My bad. I'm on. Sorry. My question was on breaking plateaus for the bench and deadlift.
Yeah. So you're out of LP?
I've been out of LP.
Well, you said been out.
Well,
are you out now? What have you been doing so far? Tell me what you've been doing.
So I've been working on like a 4-day split kind of program just because of my life schedule.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been trying to keep pushing LP, even using fractional plates. And right now my bench is hanging out around 285, 290 is like the best I can do. And
for five? Is that for five or single?
About a set of three.
Okay, very good. Yep.
And then deadlift is hanging out for a set of five. I'm just kind of stuck in that 405 spot.
Yeah. So you're deadlifting twice a week on a 4-day split, and sure. you're really, it sounds to me like you're really kind of running LP in a 4-day split. Is that right?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, this is the good kind of plateau, because you know, you just need some more work. Darn it. Cool. You know, at the end of LP, when somebody's doing training 3 days a week with 9 slots, right? A slot is just, you know, where you would program a movement. So Monday might be squat, press, deadlift. Wednesday might be squat, bench press, deadlift. Friday might be squat, press, deadlift again. That's 9 slots. Well, when LP ends there, I'll move them to a 4-day split where they have 8 slots. You're training 4 times a week, but you only have 2 movements a week, and that frees them up. We've already done that. That's good. I would have tried that. So it sounds to me like you need to periodize a little bit. You need a heavy day and you need a light day. Your 405 deadlift, or was that a triple or was that 5?
I can remember. Do 5 on the deadlift.
Mighty fine. You know, let's say Mondays and Thursdays are deadlift days.
Yep.
I would have you. I happen to know a little bit about you. We've been chatting on Instagram and stuff for quite a while. You're in your mid 30s, isn't that right? Or early 30s?
Yeah, I'm 30.
30. Yeah. So, yep. You know, you're not an old guy like me. So since you're not an old guy, I would probably have you deadlift something like 325, maybe as high as 355, somewhere 325 to 355 for 3x5 on Monday.
Okay.
And then I would have you attempt a 410. I would actually, if I was programming you and doing online coaching, I would program an AMRAP set at 410 for Thursday. I would hope that you would get 5. You got 5 at 405. So I would hope that you would get 5 at 410. But if you got 4 or you got 3, that would be okay with me. Okay. And then the next week, we would increment those things up by 5 pounds. If you got four at 410, I might actually leave you at 410 for the next week as well and try to add a rep. But man, it is a lot harder to add a rep at 410 than it is to go up 5 pounds. Because if you think about 410 for a set of five is what is that? I got to do the math in my head. That's 2,050 pounds. Well, if you add 5 pounds, your tonnage only goes up 25 pounds. If you add a rep, it goes up 410 pounds. It's a lot more work to add a rep. But so if you get four, yeah, next week we may just go ahead and try to just add that rep. If you get three, I wouldn't worry about it, and we just go up five more pounds. I tell you, and you know, a lot of people that coach probably wouldn't want to say this, but I might also consider having you lay off of deadlifting next week, or maybe unload you a bunch and give you some rest, because there's a good chance you beat yourself up pretty badly chasing that 410 and trying to get past that 405. So if you're really worn out, I might even, you know, just give you a break next week before we moved into that new kind of scheme that I outlined. So that's the deadlift, where you're going to be doing 80-85% of your heavy on your volume day on the deadlift. The bench press is a different thing. 80% on your bench press probably won't be heavy enough. So, and 3x5 won't be enough either. You're a young guy. If I'm not mistaken, you're a short-armed fellow. How tall are you?
I am 5'5", and that's not like short torso, long leg, or anything. It's proportionally 5'5".
So we have to put like a quarter in a picture next to you for scale.
Right.
I'm sorry. Since you're a short-armed guy, and you're a young guy, I would just go ahead and do just sort of that Texas method kind of thing. So you're going to have a volume day and a heavy day, just like you did for the deadlift, but the volume is going to be a whole lot more. I would have you do 5x5, and I would probably have you do it in the 90% area. Well, I take that back. Your 285 is a triple and not five, right?
Yeah.
So if it was five, now a max effort 5-rep set is not going to be as heavy as a max effort single, of course, right?
Right.
A max effort triple is going to be heavier than your max effort 5.
Right.
So since you have set a max effort 3-rep set at 285, then your volume work will need to be at a lower percentage of that than it would be of a set of five. Because the five is already a lower percentage, a lower intensity. So I would probably put you in the 85, 86, 87% of that 3-rep max for 5x5 on your volume day. And then, of course, we would chase 287.5 for your triple on your heavy day. Now, the squat and the press are now periodized, right? We got a heavy day and a light day. I'm sorry, the squat and the bench press are periodized. You have a heavy day and a light day. That's going to interfere with the other lifts some. I want you to do your heavy deadlift before you squat. This may not be optimal in terms of performance, but in terms of programming and managing your workout day, I would go ahead and periodize the other lifts as well. I'm going to assume that they are close to the end of the line. You know, we might eke out some more linear progression gains with those if we just continue doing LP inside the 4-day split. But for just housekeeping purposes, I think it's worth it to go ahead and periodize those. Would you go with the 5x5 with the same sort of percentages for the press, 5x5? And actually, I probably wouldn't go to 5x5 on squats because people typically don't need them. And remember, I like that minimum effective dose thing. So I only want to give you what I think you need. You've been doing 3x5. There's a good chance that 4x5 on volume day and a heavy set of five or a heavy triple on intensity day for the squat will get you where you need to be. I'll be putting this thing out. I'm recording this. I'll be putting this out on Scott Stream so you can listen to this and make a note. I think you're in the automobile. But that's what I would do with you. How does that sound? Does that make sense?
That makes sense. That's pretty close to what I've been doing, but I haven't been pushing, I'll say, heavy enough on the heavy days, is from what I'm looking at from my notes.
The heavy day needs to be heavy because, particularly on that deadlift, you know, if you're at 80% volume day on deadlift, you'll detrain. You know, you'll lose your top end. So you have to have something heavy in your hands, heavy on your back every week in all of these lifts, or you'll detrain. I mean, I've done it to myself, programming for myself. I tend to be too easy on myself. And I've let myself detrain as a result of not pushing the heavies enough.
Right. So on the 4 day split, one day is strictly a volume day. And the other day, like a lower body volume day, and the other day is a lower body heavy day. Is that what we're looking at?
Yes, in terms of each lift, right? Every day will have a heavy thing and a volume thing. So Monday might be your heavy squat, but your volume deadlift. Tuesday might be your heavy press, but your volume bench press, and so on, right? So you're going to do each thing heavy one week. And you'll have each day something will be heavy. And you've got 8 slots right now. So your workout shouldn't be terribly long. Nope. Listen, and here's another thing. On the bench press and the press, 3 minutes of rest, period. I mean, do whatever you want. But if I was coaching you and you and I were training partners, we would set the clock. We would be 3 minutes of rest, period. And if the weights you are moving right now are too heavy for 3 minutes of rest, then we would adjust those weights.
Okay.
On the squat and deadlift, I might go 4 minutes. I might go 5 minutes, maybe on the deadlift. But, you know, we got to manage those sessions. You know, I personally have done hundreds of 2.5 hour sessions, 3 hour sessions 4 times a week. And it's brutal. So I have found that if you reduce the weights to the point that you can do them for 3 minutes on the presses, 4 or 5 minutes on the big movements, you can make progress from there. But I like to make progress inside of those time constraints instead of using the recovery to make the progress. Because I'm not training for me. I'm just trying to be a strong person and not waste my day. Now, if you tell me you're working up for a meet, we would have a different talk about that, you know?
Yeah, I've typically been doing a timed 2 minute rest for upper body movements, about 4 minute rest for lower body movements.
I don't think 2 is enough. I see so Caleb's got his
hand up.
Yeah, kick it up to 3. So, you know, we're doing HIIT actually. When we do a heavy set of strength training stuff, we're doing high intensity interval training. So we're working on our glycogen stores and how much ATP we have in our cells. And it takes, you know, there's some research about it. And of course, everything that all research ends up being wrong. Ask Newton, ask Ptolemy, but ask the people that told us to take fish oil. But it seems to take around 3 minutes for us to replenish the ATP. That's the thing we're looking for, is like, is our ATP back? And at 2 minutes, it probably won't be. And that could cost you a rep. And of course, you know, take your creatine. That can help too.
Right. All right.
Anything else, brother?
I think you've got me taken care of right now. I'm going to run this out and I'll check back with you in a couple weeks to see how it's going.
All right. Well, thanks for listening and supporting all these channels and stuff. I appreciate you.
Thank you much.
Hey, drink your water today. It's going to be miserable.
Oh, yeah. I know it.
All right. Talk to you soon, man.
Take it.
All right. Caleb is up. Caleb is up. I'm not going to edit any of this. So if there are silences in here, you podcast people are just going to have to hit that forward 10-second button. But Caleb is here. Or he should be. Not yet.
Yes.
Oh, I put some. Hey, there you are. There you go. What is going on?
Not too much. Just enjoying the the program so far. So,
well, thank you. It's my AM radio dream.
Yeah, maybe living it out. Maybe I like it.
Yeah. So what is going on with your training? What can I help with? Maybe.
Well, I really haven't started. So my question is more of how to, you know, what the best kind of way of doing that would be, you know, when it comes to acquiring equipment and all that stuff. You know, somewhat feasible to kind of get going with it.
Right, man. I tell you what. Equipment, I'm not that up on obtaining equipment right now. You know, through all the COVID stuff and all of that, equipment became, you know, they shut down all these gyms last year, you know, and there was a huge demand for equipment as people were trying to set up their own home gyms and get moving with that. So last year, you just couldn't hardly find anything. Now from what I understand, it's better. One of my friends said that Buddy Caps emailed him and said that they actually have Texas Power Bars, American Power Bars, and stuff back in stock. So that's good to see. I'm here on the Rogue website. It looks like most of their bars are in stock, although they have all gone up, and I just got a nosebleed looking at it. So if you're going to do what we do, you need a squat rack. You need a fixed bench. Stay away from the inclined benches and the adjustable benches. You just need a flat bench. In fact, I have a client who made one out of a 2x12 and some 2x4s, and he's been using it for 3 years, and he's got some heavy, he does some heavy bench presses, 3x5 in the mid 300s on that board, and it's been fine. So you need a squat, you need a squat rack, you need a bench, and you need a good barbell. You know, you're going to spend $250 to $350 probably on a good barbell. But it's really important. The thing will be worth more in 10 years than you paid for it, and you'll be glad you did that. And then of course you need plates. A grown ass man is going to need 500 pounds of plates. You won't need that initially, but you will eventually need 500, possibly more. And then off you go. I love all the stuff that Rogue sells. I think it's the finest that's available pretty much. I would, you know, arguably maybe there are some other barbells that are better than what Rogue has, but maybe not. So I love the Ohio Power Bar at Rogue, which, let me see here. I'm on their website. Goodness. The Ohio Bar is $310 right now. The Ohio Power Bar, I don't see it. Maybe they're out of it. I love the B&R bar that you can get from Rogue, or at least you used to be able to. I love the Texas Power Bar from Buddy Caps in Texas. That bar is a little less expensive, and it's a really good bar. The Oki Power Bar that you can get from Shawnee, Oklahoma, it's a chrome bar. It's a little cheaper than the rest. I don't really like chrome, but that's also a good one, particularly if you want to spend a little bit less. Plates are plates. So whatever, get whatever you can get there. Although you'll find that some of them are less accurate than others. And, you'll have to deal with that in your presses, when they get heavier, that would be an issue probably. Now you've got your equipment. You'll also probably want to buy a belt. I think Dominion Strength makes the best belts. They're always in stock. They don't do anything custom. So if you need a vanity belt, you'll have to go somewhere else. But Dominion Strength makes great, great belts. A single ply 3-inch belt is probably all you need. If you're really a tall, tall guy, you might want a 4-inch belt, but a 3-inch belt is probably all you need. And then you just get started. On the Barbell Logic podcast, Matt Reynolds and I did a show called How to Crush It on Your First Day in the Gym or something like that. You might go listen to that, but you're going to go into the gym. You're going to take a notebook and a pencil. You're going to wear your squat shoes. I didn't mention that. You need some squat shoes, and you actually need them from day one. It makes a big difference. I wear the Rogue. I think they call them the Rogue Classic Lifters. I think that's what they're called. Let me look. Yeah, the Dewin Classic Lifter from Rogue. It's $125. It's all leather. It'll last you probably your whole life. And you go in and you load the barbell into the rack and you squat the empty bar and then you add 10 pounds for 5 reps. Then you squat for 5 more reps with 10 more pounds on it. Go up by maybe 20 more pounds. Squat 5 more reps. And when it feels like you're doing something, right? We don't want to max ourselves out. When it feels like it is somewhat effortful, stop. Write that weight down in your book. Write down the date. Write down squat. Write down 3x5, and then that weight, and you do 2 more reps at that weight. 2 more sets of 5 at that weight. Rack it, and you're done. We're going to repeat that process with the press, the overhead press, and then you're going to repeat that process with the deadlift, but with the deadlift, you're going to do 1 set of 5. Then you pack your shit up and you go home. You're going to come back 2 days later. You're going to add 5 pounds to each of those lifts. This time you're not going to do the press, though. You're going to do the bench press. You're going to go through the same process with the bench press. All the movements are going to feel funny. You're not going to know exactly where to put the bar on your back for the squat. You know, you're not going to know where to put your hands on the bar for the press. You know, it'll be awkward. It's fine. You go in there and you do it. You go in there and you do it. And you write it down in your book, and you go up by 5 pounds. You send me videos in my DMs, or you tag me in a video on Instagram, or send me a video in the chat group here at Telegram. Email it to me at scott@scotthamburg.com. I'll have a look and give you some feedback and see if we can help you get moving. And you're going to go through that process, which we call linear progression, for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 4 weeks, something like that. And we call it linear progression. Because if you graph your progress over time, because we're adding 5 pounds each session, the graph of that function is a straight line. And we're going to do that as long as you can. And you're not going to be able to do it for very long, but you'll be adding 15 pounds a week to your squat. And you can do that for quite a while. And 3 to 6 weeks later, you'll not be the same person anymore. Now, that's the quick and dirty way to do it. And well, actually, that's not the quick and dirty way. That is how to do it. But the details of how you move and how you properly squat and what the proper depth is, you know, how to brace against the belt, how to hold the bar in the deadlift, you know, what to do with your back in the squat, all those things are going to take a while for you to learn and for them to become part of your muscle memory and for you to do them properly. But the way you learn that is by doing it. If you go to the Art of Manliness YouTube channel, he has got some great videos on how to do the 4 big movements, the squat, press, bench press, and deadlift. And of course, Barbell Logic has some things they call the gym shorts on YouTube that also go over those 4 lifts. And those are shorter, quicker videos, but you should probably look at those if you like doing it the way. And get in there and go for it. There are people in the gym that are going to tell you you're not doing it right. Well, you'll look and you'll see they're not very strong, and just press on, you know, do your own thing, because they don't know. How about that? Is that what you needed to know?
Yeah, that's great. I guess the main thing that that's all super helpful, but one of the big kind of things that I was thinking about was you mentioned was where to start with the weight, you know, how much weight to start mm-hmm. with. And that makes a lot of sense to kind of ease into what feels like you're doing a little bit of something and then kind of go from there. So.
Yeah. And when I say a little bit of something, I mean, a little bit of something. You're not trying to prove anything. You're not trying to prove anything. It's your first day. You're just trying to move and you're trying to get something on the book, something to build from. If you do anything very effortful, the squat will wreck you. Your ass and your legs will be wrecked. Mm. And, you know, that's okay. I mean, you're not going to get rhabdo or anything from a first session in LP. But, you know, we don't need to get wrecked. You know, you don't need to get wrecked. You'll be sore even, you know, if you work up to 65 to 85 pounds on your squat or something like that on the first session, that's not terribly heavy, and rack it and then go home. your inner thighs and your rump and your hamstrings are still going to be a little bit sore, and that's okay. I'm not against that, but I don't want you to be wrecked. I mean, I know guys that have gone nuts with it. They get wrecked, and then they have trouble going downstairs. You know, we don't need that.
Well, is it better? I guess then, when you're starting out, is it better to you know, err on the side of lower than, you know, because you're going to catch up? Yeah. Is it? Would that just basically extend your linear progression?
Well, extend it in terms of time. It's going to end wherever it's going to end, but in terms of time, okay. Yeah. And you know, and I tell people all the time that when you're doing LP, even slow is fast. If you go up 1 pound a session 3 times a week for 52 weeks, you're still going to add 156 pounds to your squat. Mm. You know, those kinds of numbers are ridiculous. Well, you're not going to, I mean, that's, nobody can do that, you know, once they've been training for six or eight weeks. So,
yeah,
you know, even slow is really fast. So just go in there, start low.
Yeah, so there shouldn't be any fear of being like, well, you know, I think I could have done quite a bit more, you know, that day. No. Kind of start there and just kind of, yeah, okay, I see.
No individual workout means anything in this. You know, if you have a bad session, as long as you show up and you did it and you stick to your program, it's fine, because none of the workouts by themselves are meaningful, you know. So establishing the habit and not missing is going to end up, is going to make you very, very strong. So if you go and you just squat, if you went and you just squatted the bar for 3x5 and racked it, which is 45 pounds, 20 kilos, whatever, and then added 2.5 kilos or 5 pounds every session after that, you're still going to get donkey strong. It doesn't matter. Mm. So don't have any ego in it. Just go in and do it. The most important thing, really, for anybody, even, you know, even somebody that's trying to set world records, is the habit and the consistency.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense.
Everything else is far behind, you know, far a distant second. So just by showing up, you win, but you have to keep showing up. What else, man?
That's kind of, like I said, I'm just kind of on the beginning of it, trying to get everything together and start. So, so that's super helpful.
Good. Well, do it. And, you know, don't beat yourself up. Don't have an ego in it. It's the doing. It's kind of, it's kind of meditative in that way, right? It's the doing, really. And it's, you know, going into the thing without an expectation, but just doing. So, go do.
Awesome. Thanks, Scott.
All right. Thanks, man. Okay, we got a Steven here, but it's spelled Stephen. I don't know about that. Hello, sir. I don't know what the lag is here. I heat people up, and then it takes them a while.
Hey, can you hear me?
I can.
Yeah, that's the biblical spelling, or at least the anglicized biblical spelling.
Yeah, now we're going the anglicized biblical spelling, yeah, whatever that means. Yeah. Is it the Scofield Bible? Is that where it came from?
Yeah.
I don't know. What's going on, man?
Oh, not much. You know, appreciate all of the hours that you've published on barbell training over the years. I guess I've probably been strength training for since 2018. Nowadays, I'm kind of going back through a linear progression after a little bit of a layoff, and I had a wrist injury. And then getting back to kind of where I ended on the previous LP, which was up around 425, 3x5, 425 on the squats, which was an all-time PR for that kind of sets and reps scheme. And just wondering, like, what I know you guys have, you between you and Reynolds on the other shows, have talked about all kinds of ways you can go after that. And the last time I switched from LP to something else, we were doing I was doing a kind of a 4-day split. Just wondering what are your thoughts about the 4-day split on a 3-time-a-week method, because I really like the, I'm lazy in that I don't want to train 4 days a week.
Yeah,
I like getting it done in 3 days.
I have a lot of folks. I have a lot of folks that I put where I split their 1 week training cycle into four sessions, and then they train three times a week, which means that it takes them 9 or 10 days to finish that 4 day training cycle. And it's fine. You know, if you're training Monday, Wednesday, Friday, there's going to be 1 week where you squat twice and 1 week where you squat once. And you can say the same thing about the other four lifts. Maybe that's not optimal. You know, a lot of people in this sort of world get really hung up on optimal. I really don't care about that. I just want to make sure that everybody trains with enough frequency to get strong and stay strong. And three times a week is going to get you there. So I think it works. I think it works great. It isn't optimal. I don't really care about that. You know, if I write up an optimal program for you and you don't want to train 4 days a week and you won't, and you're missing sessions, well, now we're worse off. So I think it's great. I don't even see it as a weak, I don't even see it as a weak compromise either. I think it's perfectly adequate. What were you going to say?
I was just going to say I've done optimal before. You know, I trained with Harry was my online coach for a while before kind of COVID shut everything down. Yeah. Yeah. And he had me on what, you know, was probably the optimal setting leading up to a meet that I did.
Right.
I got feedback from the wife and kids that optimal in the gym does not mean optimal at home, because
right,
it's you're waking up early to train and you're eating everything in the house and you're grumpy. So if that's yep. not what your overall objective is in life, to be as strong as you possibly can be, then you probably should adjust training to suit.
Yeah.
And that's where I'm at.
Yeah, I have lived with a competitive lifter for a long time. And when they're getting ready for a meet, it's the primary thing. It sucks. It sucks for everybody else. It's probably not a healthy thing for family people.
Yeah.
So the three times a week is great. I'll tell you what's a little better than that. If you don't want to train, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday on a traditional 4 day split, just training every other day works a little better than the 3 day split. So if you just train Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, Monday, like that, you know, it mm-hmm. increases the frequency just a little bit, but not as demanding as that regular 4 day split. So you'll be fine. You'll be fine. And I'll tell you, there's nothing wrong. Like if you decide, pressing twice a week this week and then once next week isn't enough frequency because my press is stalled, for example, there's nothing wrong with you throwing in another press session inside that 4 day split so that you press twice a week.
Yeah.
Right. There's yeah. nothing wrong with that. So when you're training twice a week three times a week on a 4 day split, you're doing two movements three times a week. So that's six total slots. There ain't nothing wrong, and it doesn't cost you much to throw in one more slot and do that movement one more time a week. So ain't nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, that sounds good. I think I'm about to the point. I'll probably squeeze out, you know, like I said, before the wrist injury, I did 425 on the squat, and I kind of always use the squat as the barometer for when I switch. And
right.
When that gets heavy, usually everything else is there too, like with respect to the bench and everything. But I'll probably get 430, maybe notch that on the 3x5 and then switch it up, just because, I don't know, I start to get bicep tendonitis whenever things get heavy for that, you know, every other day doing a big heavy squat like that. At least heavy
yep.
for me.
Yeah. But no, that's 420 for 3x5 is heavy. The end, period.
Yeah. I think one time, maybe it was you, maybe it was someone else, but they said, you know, what does a heavy squat feel like? And it's like, well, it's always heavy to whoever's doing it. You know, if you're doing a heavy squat for you, that's heavy. That's what it feels like.
Yeah. That's Ed Cohn that said that. But it's true. And then in absolute terms, 420 for 3x5 is heavy.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, you're able to move enough tonnage there that, you know, a 600 single is in your future if you care. You know, you probably shouldn't care.
Because yeah, it
sounds like you're
a
person, you're a family, and you're trying to be a human, so you probably shouldn't care. But if you did, like that is in the realm of possibility, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll see. I mean, life ebbs and flows, doesn't it? But the other thing, I did have one other question if nobody else is hanging out waiting to ask theirs. So I got kind of a traditional, maybe I think it's a B&R bar back in the day, three years ago, and I live down on the Gulf Coast, and it does get this rusty patina. What's your advice for making this thing last, as far as should I worry about the rust developing on it? I got a wire brush and kind of brush it off once a week just to get all the chalk and everything off of it. But
well, we have the same problem here, although we don't have salt in the air like maybe you do, I don't know. But and I have unfinished, you know, raw steel bars, and they're going to rust, and it's going to get on your shirt for a little while, and that's okay. Just get some 3-in-1 oil, wipe it with that. You know, maybe scrub it with that, with a rag and 3-in-1 oil, perhaps. And get a nylon bristle brush. So if the knurling is filling up with, like, chalk and, you know, Steven dander, just take that nylon brush and brush it out of the knurling. But you don't want to remove that rust. You want to oil that rust so that you end up making an oxide layer on that thing, and it'll eventually quit rusting.
Yeah.
It will quit rusting such that it comes off on your hands, and it'll turn kind of a, you know, dark brown color, almost black, and then you'll be in a stable place. But if you scrub the shit out of it with a wire brush, you know, once a week, you're removing that oxide, and it's just going to keep coming back. So oil it, and it'll stop
rusting. Yeah, that's interesting. The nylon brush, I hadn't thought about that, because a wire brush is just going to get back to bare metal and then start all over.
Yeah, again. It's too much. Yeah, it could even be like a nylon brush, like you might keep at the kitchen sink or something. It doesn't have to be too tough. And you're just doing that to, you know, make sure the knurling's not full and it's still a grippy, nice bar, you know?
Yeah. No, that's a good point.
Anything else?
No, appreciate you giving us your time here.
Hey, well, glad to. Let me know if you need some more. We'll do one of these. I don't know, maybe once a month, something like that. Maybe a little more. Check in with us again.
Yeah, and then maybe just say to anybody who's, you know, on the fence about starting this sort of thing, I got into it because I was a runner of sorts. I mean, that's just what you do. Like, it's like, oh, you need to be healthy, so you run. And then one day, I came back after doing a 6-mile long run on the weekend and laid down on the couch, and I was like, well, my feet hurt, my knees hurt, and my kids were young at the time. I mean, they're still young, but had young kids, and they were like, you know, wanted to go play and roll around on the floor and all this stuff. And I was telling them, I was like, I can't do that. I've been, you know, I ran this morning, I can't do any of this stuff. And I was like, this is a little bit backwards. Shouldn't be disabled because of my exercise routine. So started in on this, and, you know, with all of the content that you guys put out there, it made it very easy to get going, and eventually did some training with Harry on the program, and did a meet and everything. You know, now it's just becomes a part of your lifestyle. Like, you fold it in even when it's hard. So if you're on the fence about doing it, I like how you address the first caller. Just go do it. Just start. It'll be wrong. You'll have to correct some things along the way, but in the end, you'll be a different person because of it.
Yeah, perfection is the enemy of the good here. Got to just get on it. Well, hey, thanks, man. Big squat numbers. Congratulations. Let me know how it's going.
Will do. I'll post a video if I get 430.
No, you'll get it. You may not get it for 3x5, but you'll get it soon. You'll get it for 5 real soon. All right. Thank you, sir.
Yep. Take care.
Right, bye. What else saw you people? We've got a bunch of people in here. Let's see if somebody wants to pop a hand up. I'll tell you, it was a little over a year ago. What was it, 3-4 years ago that we started the Barbell Logic podcast? I can't remember how many years, 3 or 4. We started it on, the first show came out on July 4th, whatever year that was. And I think it was 2017. Can't remember, but I recorded, I don't know, 300 or 350 episodes of that show. And boy, it was time for me to get off of there. I just couldn't hardly stand to talk about this shit anymore. It's been good to take a break from broadcasting on this topic. It's been good to take a break, and it's nice to be back too. But let's see if anybody else has any questions. I had a lot of questions on that came to me on Instagram, but I would rather than answer questions from Instagram, I would rather talk to you folk about it. Let's see here. But if none of you clowns are going to raise your hand, we'll have to go in here and read some of these damn questions. I did get one question. It's a question that I hate. Sorry. Just because I don't like a question doesn't mean you shouldn't ask it. But here's one about, I said, what do we need to discuss on the strength training call-in tomorrow? And somebody says, actually, the first comment I got was becoming a coach. And I don't know. A lot of folks like to talk about that, but I'm, you know, frankly, I'll be the only honest person. I'm just not interested in helping people become competition. Sorry. You know, you can listen to my shows, you can listen to Barbell Logic, you can go read, there are numerous books on the subject that are excellent, and go study. But I've never really been in the, other than my children, never been in the business of creating competition. For me, this is a business. I like it. I give a lot to, you know, potential to lifters and, you know, in the culture. I like to think I do. I certainly try to, but as far as, like, you know, helping somebody become a coach, not interested. Somebody else here, somewhat of a spook on Instagram. Again, you can follow me there. I'm Scott_Silverstrength. You can follow me to see announcements when these shows are coming up. You can also follow Scott Stream, my channel, on Telegram, and I'll schedule our shows in there so you can see those and be part of this next one we do. Somewhat of a spook says that I should discuss how to train and manage recovery while playing a sport. That's hard to talk about in the abstract if I don't know what your sport is and what your training schedule is for that sport. I really can't speak to strength training to support your main sport. I don't know. But most sports have an off season and an on season, of course, unless you're a, you know, junior high or high school soccer player, in which case they never stop. You don't get an off season until you tear an ACL if you play soccer in the United States. So maybe it's that way in other places too. I don't know. But in general, how to train and manage recovery while playing a sport, you're going to try to drive strength gains and focus on intensity in the gym in the off season. Clearly, after every season, after every performance season in your primary sport, you're probably going to run a little LP again, and off season may only be long enough for you to run LP and a couple of weeks of, you know, early intermediate training, but you're going to do everything you can with your strength in that time. And then you're going to have to make sure that your strength training doesn't interfere with your sport when it's, you know, performance season. So, you want to make sure that you are fully recovered before the performance event. So if you play football and you have Friday night football games, you know, you need to not lift anything heavy after Wednesday morning. You need to make sure that your strength training does not interfere with practicing your skills. And like I said, you got to make sure that you're completely recovered in time for the performance event. So, you know, without knowing what that sport is and knowing what that schedule is, I don't have a lot more to say about that. But we could certainly come up with a regimen that would hopefully keep you from detraining during the performance season and get you to gain weight. Potentially, maybe you don't even want to gain weight. You know, maybe you're in a damnable sport that requires you to restrict your weight, you know, restrict your size like a bonsai tree, in which case we could probably manage that too, although I'm not interested in that. I have problems with that for people who are under 18. I think it's negligent to restrict the growth of non-adults. Pop up those questions, guys. I'm only going to do one more from the writing here unless we've got another one. Oh, here's Jason Cobb. Let's go allow Jason to speak. Click. All right. There's a little lag between the time I turn this on and you can hear me and you can speak, but what is going on with your training and how can I help you, man?
Good morning, sir. Can you hear me?
I can. 10 by 10. Hey. What's going on?
You brought me to this platform this morning trying to learn it. I was just curious. You said you were tired of talking about this stuff. Are you tired of coaching? Are you doing coaching now? Is it mostly your own thing? Are you still doing the stuff with Reynolds? You know, what's going on with you on the coaching side?
I still coach. I do online coaching at Barbell Logic, barbell-logic.com. I enjoy that. Let's see, what year is it? So 2019, November 2019, I stopped doing in-person coaching. The schedule, you know, having to be there at a certain time and do the certain thing with a certain person at that certain time, frankly, was cramping my style, man. But my wife and I both, Charity and I both, had a pretty significant in-person coaching practice, but we nuked that. And, you know, I'm glad we did, because 5 months later, COVID nuked it anyway. We wouldn't have had much luck with that anyhow. And then we had a house in town with a great home gym that we used to train out of, and we sold that house, and I'm living in a barn now. I have a squat rack in my bedroom. I don't have a place to, you know, host people and do in-person training. So the only people I coach are my kids, my wife, and the occasional friend that comes by. But I do the online coaching and enjoy that. Mostly enjoy that. It's like any other job. There are things about it that are frustrating and certain clients that are frustrating, and they know who they are because I fucking tell them all the time. Will, I love Will, but God, frustrating. He knows I'm frustrated. So, you know, helping a specific person that's maybe not right in front of you, but I have a specific person online and I see their progress every day and I get to know something about them, is good and has held my interest more than, you know, podcasting to people who weren't there. you know, Reynolds and I would record and we would, you know, speak to each other and we were certainly in the room, and the idea that listeners were listening, that idea was also in the room, but it's a little abstract, you know, you know, having real people to coach makes it less abstract and therefore holds my interest. You know, as much as everybody thinks I'm grumpy and stuff, the reason I'm grumpy is because I actually care about people. So when they fuck up, I'm deeply offended. So, you know, being able to help, you know, individual people is still good. And doing that, that's one of the reasons I thought, well, I'll do a call-in show, because if I can actually speak to people about it, you know, that'll be good. Instead of, you know, trying to tailor a message to an unknown, unnamed, unseen, imagined listener that we hope is the right sort of client or listener avatar, this is a whole lot better. Yeah.
Gotcha. Well, gotcha. In terms of training questions, so I've been really lax on my own training over basically this whole summer. Just had my focus on other things, growing the business and doing a bunch of construction projects and all kinds of different things. So like I know the answer, like when you restart, you just do your NLP again and get it going. But I guess, where would you start the NLP? So I think my top squat singles like 425 or something like that. Probably late last year.
You know, guys that have gotten decently strong and then lay out and then come back and start over LP are in grave danger of really wrecking themselves. Not getting injured, but just hitting it way too hard. Like a guy that's never done LP before, like 185 might be the heaviest 3x5 he could do. And he'd do 3x5 at 185, which would be maybe max effort for a first session. And then, you know, 2 days later, he's going to be wobbly and he's going to have trouble getting to the bathroom when he gets up in the morning, you know. A guy like you that squatted 420, you might be able to get in the 255, 275, 300 area even for a first session. So if you do that, dude, you'll be devastated, even though, you know, you can do it and that's a good thing, but man, you'll be devastated. The soreness, the DOMS will be pretty tough. So, you know, just pick something reasonable, you know, that just, it's just on your back and feels good and just go, you know. I would guess that you're going to, you know, maybe 135, 185, something like that. Do two sets of five and rack it. Don't have any ego. Do two sets of five at 135, 185, something like that. Do two sets of five, rack it. Come back the next time. Maybe do that on Monday. Come that again on Wednesday. Do three sets of five at that same weight and then proceed. And you might proceed by doing 20-pound increments, 20-pound jumps for some time, or 10-pound jumps, or even 5-pound jumps. Don't worry about it. The thing is, you're back and you're doing it again. That's the thing, you know? I've been dealing with the same thing. I got, we sold the house, didn't really have a gym. Did that in July last year. Put together a gym in a little crappy one-car garage in this rental property you had, and then which was miserable, and then got the Wu flu in October, which wrecked me, and then moved again in late January, and you know, I just ended up LP again. I'm not very strong, but you know, I'm doing it, and that's the thing. So get in there and do it.
All right, thank you, sir.
Yeah. What else? Anything else?
That's it for me.
All right. Well, thanks for getting up this morning and getting on Telegram at long last. I was slow to get there. Yeah. Anybody else? Come on. There's enough folks in here to get it going. Let's see here. Hoosier Barbell. This is one of these that was written in to me. Hoosier Barbell says, where is it? Can you discuss whether or not you use a reverse hyper, and if it would be a good investment? I don't use one. There you go. So there's not much to discuss there. Rogue has one. It's $800. It's $795. Westside makes, they call it a bent pendulum reverse hyper extension machine. It's $3,141. So if it's $800, you buy the Rogue one. That's nice. I mean, that's not a horrible price tag. It's not great, but it's not horrible. But the bad thing about it is the footprint it takes up in the gym. The floor space it takes up in the gym, it's extraordinary. The things are big. First, it's got a big footprint because you don't want it to tip over, and then by the time you're kicking those legs out on this thing, you know, you've got to have a lot of empty space behind it, so you're not knocking stuff over and whatever. They work great. I have a client that has some lower back problems, and he got one, and we have him use it at least one time a week. But for me, it's always the squat and the deadlift. It's for me, it's always the rack pull. So I say deadlift, I really mean deadlift and its variants, you know, particularly the rack pull or the block pull. Love those things for folks with lower back troubles. And, you know, it uses, it puts the equipment we have to good use and doesn't take up any extra floor space. But I have nothing. I have nothing in particular against the reverse hyper machine, other than just so darn big. Hey, here's a Paul. Paul is his name, and he wants to ask a question, I hope. What's up, Paul?
Hey, Scott, can you hear me?
I can. Perfect.
Okay. Yeah, I do have a question. Same thing as some of the other folks in here. I've trained in the past, trained by myself, got decently strong, you know, hit the 200, 300, 400, 500 benchmarks. Yeah, I've kind of hurt myself a little bit on the squat, kind of developed some tendonitis because I was bouncing at the bottom in my knees. And I, yeah. I think I need to go see a coach. So I don't, you know, in person, and I don't know what your experience has been coaching people in person that have trained by themselves, you know, for long periods of time. What should I expect? You know, I want to get my form in order, I guess, is my question. And I'm wondering what to expect there.
Well, since you are a guy who has hit the 200 pound press, the 300 pound bench press, the 400 pound squat, the 500 pound deadlift, I say that because not everybody knows what 2, 3, 4, 5 means. You can't really do them. You can't really hit those kind of numbers doing it all wrong. Like, you've got patellar tendonitis, so you probably had some knee slide. You're bouncing, we call it bouncing off your knees in the squat. But the thing wasn't an absolute shit wreck, which I have seen. So you probably don't need a lot of help. You're probably going to be able to go, where are you? What town are you in?
I'm in Ohio. I'm in Columbus.
Yeah.
I think there's a gym maybe in Cincinnati that's getting ready to open up. That I was thinking about taking some trips down there, and I was thinking, well, can I get it straightened out in one trip? Do I need to make many trips, or maybe look for something
else? Yeah, you can. Yeah, Cincinnati. Sorry, Cincinnati's opening up there. My friend Marie Kunkel is there. She'll be able to help you. You could probably get it straightened up in one session, frankly, or maybe one session a month for a little while, and then maybe every 6 months go in and get a checkup. I suspect that kind of thing will get you taken care of. You can go, let's see, he's in Michigan. I was going to say Chris Carrisco, but he's in Michigan. I was thinking he was in Ohio. Yeah, one session is going to help you a whole bunch, and then you know, maybe once a month, and then maybe, you know, twice a year after that. As your body changes, as your shape and your weight and your age changes, and as the weight on your back and in your hands changes, the form will feel different. The form should never change, but it will feel different, right? As your legs and your rump get bigger, you'll start squatting higher because it feels tight at a higher weight, you know? So you'll start squatting high, and that's just one example. And then as it gets heavier, little things that you do wrong that weren't of consequence when you were squatting 275 get you some patellar tendonitis, which is zero fun. So go get some checkups. But if I was doing online coaching for you, we could probably fix it. Well, not probably, we could fix it. I would back the weight off a lot to the point that it wasn't an effort. And for a guy that squatted as heavy as you are, that might be 225. And I would have you squat to a box with a tubo, the terribly useful block of wood. I would put a block of wood in front of your toe, and I would forbid you from touching that block of wood with your knee. and have you reach way back and not touch your butt on the box, but touch your hamstrings on the box to make sure you're leaning over and reaching back enough. And I think we could probably stop that knee slide. We could probably stop that knee slide with that. Probably would need to take care with programming to make sure that the inflammation goes away. You know, if we drive the weight up too much frequency, too much volume, too much tonnage, too much, you'll have a heck of a time getting rid of that. So you're probably going to need a rest. You know, the longer you've had a tendonitis and tendinosis, the longer it takes to get rid of that. So we need to be patient and take the time to let it dissipate, take your anti-inflammatories and let it dissipate, and then and drive it back up with, you know, with no knee slide henceforth, you know. So going and seeing somebody in person can help. I will say this, you will be able to get the instruction that you need as an experience, because you're an experienced lifter. You'll be able to get that instruction and grok what it is immediately. But sometimes dudes like you have a lot of muscle memory, and it will take a lot of reps to, you know, break those old patterns and get you moving properly every time from now on. So that's why, you know, that's why the online thing could potentially be good. It's lower cost, and just making sure that you use that Tubo and that box is going to get you where you need to be. Does that jive? Does that sound right?
It does. Yeah. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. I just also wanted to say thanks. I've, you know, listened to a lot of, you know, the podcast with you and Reynolds, and really enjoyed them. And I learned something today, even when you were talking about, you know, I'm a long rester, I guess, between my sets. And I have these things that, you know, stretch out to an hour and a half and more. And so I think I may, you know, take your approach and tighten it up a little bit on the rest.
Yeah, I'll say it again. I mean, I just said it, but I'll say it again. There's nothing wrong with resting. You know, so if you read Ripito, he's going to tell you to rest as long as it takes to get it done. And there's nothing wrong with that, but there is something wrong with that. You know, we got a life here. You know, if we're a competitive lifter, we need to go ahead and take that time. But otherwise, I think it's fine. I think it's great to just set some time constraints and then train within those. You can still get very, very strong training within your time constraints. It's just going to take longer. And, you know, my opinion about this has sort of changed. As I've gotten stronger, I'm, you know, people probably say I'm a puss or whatever, but I'm not real interested in getting back to like PR numbers, like right away. You know, I'm not super fired up about max effort, you know, shit like tomorrow. You know, so if I'm making good progress, I'm making good use of my time, I'm still able to eat what I need to eat, I'm looking good, I'm moving well in the gym, I'm making progress. That's the thing for me at this point. And I think, you know, there is a time in everybody's training life where they need to be just driving the numbers, no question about it. But for most of us people that try to have like a multifaceted life, you know, fostering a sustainable, I hate that word because everybody's fucked that word out. We can't even use it now. But fostering a sustainable habit of training, I think, is more important. So, you know, training within those time constraints is what's up, I think, for most folks. Anything else, Paul?
No, yeah. I've just, you know, I've definitely found that. I've found that if I can keep my time warm up to completion about an hour, I'm much more consistent overall. And so I just kind of struggle to do that with those long rests, but might tighten that up and see how it goes.
Yeah. Tighten it up. You may have to back off the weights. Anyway, chances are you will have to back off the weights a little bit. It's fine. Don't worry about it. Don't have any ego in it, man. We're trying to do a good job and trying to be consistent, and the strength will come. The body will respond, and it will do what we need it to do. Yeah. Well, thanks for getting up this morning and jumping on here. All right. Who else? Oh, Paul still wants to speak. Oh, no, he doesn't. All right. Anybody else? I don't know. Is there a clock on this thing? How do we know how long we've been on here? Oh, an hour four. An hour four. I'll hang around just a little bit longer and see if anybody else has anything else. I'm going to eventually, I hate to do this because I'm so disagreeable, but I will probably eventually come up with a set schedule for doing these. You know, maybe I'll do them like every other Thursday morning at this time or something like that so that people can put it, mark it on their calendar. But I'm going to do call-ins and I'm not going to do them all on strength. You know, we'll do them on, we'll do some of these on books. We'll do some of these on, you know, finance and economics, you know, these, all these things that kind of interest me. And if it doesn't interest you all, well, that's tough. But I'm probably going to kind of mix it up on these shows. And then of course I will put these on the Scott Stream podcast and also on the Scott, on scotthambrick.com. And I'm looking right now, I'm actively looking for a mimeograph machine. So if anybody has a working mimeograph machine, those things are scarce as hen's teeth, man. Let me know because I'm gonna start an old timey. See, old timey means like 1980s and 70s now. An old timey zine, Z-I-N-E, mimeograph the thing, get some subscribers at some, you know, reasonable low price, and send out a monthly zine and try to be less dependent on all of these social media vampires that are trying to ruin our lives. Here's Adam has a question. I just clicked the allow to speak button. What's up? The delay is killing us. We've got to work on this telegram. What's up, Adam?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
Just a quick question for you. I'm about a 300-pound bencher. Been lifting for about 3 years. And recently I suffered what a physical therapist told me was a shoulder impingement in my left shoulder. I'm still able to do moderately heavy bench pressing. However, anything overhead really hurts and creates a lot of like clicking and popping noises and sensations. Mm-hmm. I was just wondering if you had any advice on how to continue forward training under those circumstances.
Oh Lord. The shoulder joint's a piece of junk. It's more of a cage than a joint. You know, it's a cage that has like, you know, three or four elements to it with the head of your humerus kind of loosely held in that cage by all that stuff that we call a rotator cuff, which is a stupid descriptor. It's not really a cuff. And anyway, it's a junky joint. And for somebody to say, okay, you have an impingement, that could mean a lot of different things, man. That could mean a whole bunch of stuff. You know, I have people that come to me and they have an impingement syndrome. And I see I find out that it's because they're pressing wrong or because they've been doing lateral raises or their grip is too wide or whatever for the bench. And we correct the form and take our ibuprofen and rub our Voltaren gel on that thing and it goes away. And then it's onward and upward from there, you know? But, I don't know what you got there. I don't know what you've got, but I haven't seen much that can't be trained around. I would probably need to have you take a Sharpie, or better yet, a tattoo needle, and tattoo an X on the place that hurts so that I can see it in a photograph. And then we would look at your form and figure out, you know, what is it that Adam's doing here? And we can probably either modify the movements or correct your form and make that problem go away. Make it go away. I've done it many, many times. Now, you may have something else going on there that can't be mediated or remediated by, you know, fixing the form. You might have something that's really screwed up. I don't know, but it's not a death sentence. I've got guys that have shoulder replacements, many, many clients that have, you know, had different kind of rebuilds. Charity's had one, and she set U.S. records and pressed very, very, very heavy, you know, 163 for a triple as a chick on a rebuilt shoulder. So you can, you can do well short of a rebuild even. I don't know, man. I don't know. We'd have to work together, and I'd have to look at it. You know, we'd have to watch some videos of you, listen to it, look at where it hurts, maybe even look at some imaging. I ain't no doctor, but I'm pretty sure that we could change the range of motion, change your grip, change this, change that, and get you cooking again.
Okay. Thank you.
I haven't seen much that is a training death sentence. You know, it's like ascending aorta aneurysm is like pretty much the only thing. And it doesn't sound like you have that.
Not yet.
Yeah, not yet. Take the vaccine. You might get it. There you go. All right. Anything else, guys? Thanks, Adam. I just muted you there. Anything else? Well, I'll vamp a little bit more here and then we'll sign off. Yeah, so Instagram has blocked a few of my posts. So I'm not that interested now in broadcasting there. I'm going to broadcast there almost strictly to support this and my ScottHamburg.com website and OnlineGreatBooks.com. You know, I try to give folks a whole bunch, but, you know, I'm shilling for the stuff I do. So go there and check out those things. If you go to ScottHamburg.com, I have a down at the very, 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 very bottom of the thing, you can sign up for my email list, which I have never emailed to, by the way. But if you want to make sure that you and I can reach each other when I finally get canceled, you can go there to ScottHamburg.com, scroll down all the way to the bottom of the page and join the little email list there. And then, like I said, I'm looking for that mimeograph machine. I want to do an old timey zine. So when I find that, help me find one of those. When I find that darn thing, I will use that email list to get in contact with you guys and let you know where to sign up for that. We'll send that out. We'll talk about personal finance and books and politics and strength training and just kind of whatever's bugging me at the time. We'll get that thing cooking. It'll take a while, but we'll get there. Anything else? We'll turn this like an auction. Anything else going? And if there is nothing else, go to ScottHamburg, like I said, .com and sign up. And then listen for these other shows. You can go listen to me on the Music and Ideas podcast. Did a show, I'm counting, about 4 weeks ago on Outlaw Country. That was a popular show. Folks enjoyed that. Did one last week on Trent Jones, one of Trent Jones' favorite albums, the Depeche Mode's Violator, which he's sadly mistaken about. And this week we're recording. In fact, when I get off of here, we're recording one on Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon, which has grown on me. I didn't used to like that, but it has grown on me. We'll be talking about that one. And then the Online Great Books podcast is coming out later today is with our friend Malachi Walsh, who has written a book called Socratic Scribbling based on some seminars he was leading at Online Great Books. So looking forward to that. You can go get his book there on, goodness gracious, I'm losing my mind, at onlinegreatbooks.com. And there's an audiobook from Oswald Spengler that I've recorded there, and we've got some other stuff. Anyway, that's enough shilling. Record those questions that you guys have. Write those things down. And we'll do another one of these. And if you want to have one, I don't know, about small business, personal finance, politics, whatever. We're going to talk about everything here. And anyone that comes to the show and then bitches about what I talk about will be blocked from the channel. Legit complaints about errors in fact and so on are welcome, but bitching is not. All right, that being said, thank you guys so much for coming, and we'll talk to you on the next time.